I'm impressed with myself with.
Sometimes I'm not. Most of the time I'm not. Now, handle, you're damn good at this. I'm telling you, I'm speaking to myself now. Tell you, you know what? Let's take a break. I'll just keep on congratulating myself. Great human being.
Bill Handel.
So smart.
Mornings from 6 to 10.
KFI.
KFI. Live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app.
KFI.
And KOST HD2.
Los Angeles, Orange County. Live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app.
Stop the spread. I'm Brian Bruman from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. Health officials in South Africa are working to slow the spread of the Omicron variant discovered there a few weeks ago. The country has gone from a period of low transmission to the rapid growth of new cases. COVID numbers in the country are still relatively low, but scientists studying the case growth say they think the new variant could be responsible for up to 90% of new cases there in the last 2 weeks. Malls across SoCal are expected to be extra busy this weekend.
South Coast Plaza's Deborah Van Downey says with supply chain issues, many people want to do their shopping in person and guarantee they get their hands on what they want.
It's created a little bit of a frenzy in the shopping world, but it's exciting.
She says some retailers have airshipped their product and aren't facing major shortages. A survey by the International Council of Shopping Centers has found that 76% of consumers plan to head to a shopping center or mall over Thanksgiving weekend. In Costa Mesa, Blake Trolley, KFI News.
A property shark study has found that 70% of zip codes with the priciest real estate are in California.
No state in the U.S. compares to California in terms of expensive zip codes or expensive real estate for that matter.
Researcher Eliza Feast says all the zip codes in California that made the list are in the Bay Area and Southern California. New York State came in second on the list. It has more than 50 fewer expensive areas than California. A retired L.A. cop stepson is being sought for questioning in a stabbing death. The Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department named Tyrell Day a person of interest in the killing of Daryl Lee at a home in Palmdale on Wednesday. Authorities say Day is considered armed and dangerous. No further details were released. Some places across the U.S. have been dealing with a major increase in murders during the pandemic. A man killed in Philadelphia Friday night has set a new high for murders in the city.
The 501st homicide victim in the city this year, surpassing Philadelphia's record set in 1990. 2021 is also the deadliest year in the history of Indianapolis, which recorded its 246th homicide. That surpasses the record set 1 year ago.
ABC's Brian Clark says Indianapolis plans to put about a third of its federal COVID-19 relief funding towards public safety. SoCal weather from KFI, sunny by the afternoon, low 70s at the beaches, upper 70s to low 80s in metro LA and OC with some light winds, low to mid 80s in the inland valleys, upper 60s to mid 70s in the inland empire, temperatures staying much the same for the rest of the week. Right now it's 50 degrees in Encino, 52 in Inglewood, 48 in Brea, and 48 in Irvine. We lead local from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. I'm Brian Bruman.
If you love trivia, if you love the hugely popular Stuff You Should Know podcast, then the Trivial Pursuit game, Stuff You Should Know edition, is for you. With 600 questions, weird and unbelievable trivia in categories like myths, legends, and conspiracies. SYSK selects a mix of topics handpicked by podcast hosts Josh and Chuck. Give the gift of trivia this holiday. Find Trivial Pursuit, the Stuff You Should Know edition, at your favorite retailer or wherever you shop for board games.
Amazon Delivery Service Partners are hiring full-time delivery drivers to meet growing customer demand. Earn at least $19.50 per hour at select stations, plus benefits, and a sign-on bonus of $2,000 from participating DSPs if you apply now. Apply today at www.amazon.com/driver. That's www.amazon.com/driver. No delivery experience required. Terms apply. Hourly rate includes a limited time incentive for delivering a route full time between October 17th to December 25th, 2021.
Proper caregiving can improve a seriously ill family member's quality of life. And while caregiving can be demanding, it can also be very rewarding, summoning the best of our humanity. Contributing to family members' well-being can have undeniable and long-lasting positive effects for both the patient and the caregiver. California's Paid Family Leave Program provides partial wage replacement benefits to California workers who take time off from work to care for an ill family member.
This is your moment. The moment to care for your aging parents or grandparents. To be there to help them when they truly need it. To lend a helping hand. Or just a hand to hold. If you have an aging parent or grandparent, Paid Family Leave can be replacement. There is use of timeliness to give them the attention they need. This is your moment. take it. To learn more, visit californiapaidfamilyleave.com. Moments matter.
Contractor license 1047781.
Ken, it's Ken. What's the deal with the flashlight?
What do you mean?
Like on our billboards and on our trucks and stuff.
That kid with the flashlight is me, Zach. Explain that to me.
Sorry,
my dad was a big time expert. So back when I was in grade school, he would always take me with him on repair calls at night.
Made you hold the flashlight, didn't he?
Yeah, and he would always explain to me how he diagnosed the problem.
That's a good dad, that's what that is.
And then he would show me the right way to fix it, not the easy way.
So that flashlight is a symbol, huh?
That flashlight says an expert will always see the problem that the other guys can't see.
That's why you make sure all our guys are experts.
Yeah, and when you repair things the right way, not the easy way, you're like that beam of light.
Always doing the right thing for the customer.
That's what the flashlight means, Zach.
Thanks for telling me, Ken.
Gell, G-O-E-T-T-L.
We know our business, and we know it well.
KFI, AM 640. More stimulating talk.
What punishment would you exact on an 8- and 5-year-old who disobeyed you?
No more playing in the woods.
They'll play in the house on an iPad. That's what they'll do.
You want nature?
No.
You don't get any nature.
There's an app for that.
Gary and Shannon.
Yeah.
Weekdays at 10 a.m. on KFI.
KFI, AM 640.
Double T. This is Robbie Robertson, Once Were Brothers, from the soundtrack of the documentary of the same name, obviously chronicling the story career of the legendary folk rock band, The Band. Coming up next, writer, podcaster, researcher, author Micah Hanks will be here to discuss the proposed establishment of something called the Anomaly Surveillance and Resolution Office by the Department of Defense, which could include a rapid response team for UFO field investigations. It could also focus on UFO incidents around nuclear bases and the possible collection and study of UFO materials, both past and present. Micah Hanks, that conversation in about 3 minutes, right here on Coast to Coast AM.
Right now, I'm getting bombarded with TV ads, postcards, and emails about Medicare Advantage programs, saying what I may be eligible for and what might be available. But don't tell me everything there is to know. Tell me what I need to know.
Clear up your Medicare confusion with simple, easy answers at EasyMedicare.com. That's the letter E, the letter Z, Medicare.com. Go to EasyMedicare.com or speak with a licensed agent at 1-888-486-1662. EasyMedicare.com. easymedicare.com.
Speak with a licensed insurance agent or visit easymedicare.com Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 11 p.m. EST, Saturday, 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. EST. The Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS, has neither reviewed nor approved this information with regard to the federal Medicare program. easymedicare.com is powered by eCalibone Insurance, Inc., a private duly licensed insurance agency, appointed by Medicare Advantage, HMO, PPO, and PFFS plans, and standalone prescription drug plans and insurance companies holding Medicare contracts approved by CMS. Enrollment in any plans or coverage is subject to insurance company approval. This information is not a complete description of benefits. Contact the plan for more information. Limitations, co-payments, and restrictions may apply. Benefits, premiums, and or member cost share may change on January 1 of each year. You must continue paying your Medicare Part B premium.
Fever is the leading symptom of COVID and the flu, and the only way to reliably detect it is with an accurate thermometer. Be vigilant and be accurate with the Exergen Temple Scanner, whose accuracy has been proven in more than 100 clinical studies. Don't rely on non-contact thermometers. They're proven to be inaccurate and will not reliably detect a fever that might mean COVID. Be sure to seek medical advice at the first sign of fever. Learn more at Exergen.com.
Is your current home loan the right fit for you? Near historic low rates may be a great reason to refinance, but when matched with an expertly chosen loan from Loan Depot, you could be saving money and paying more towards the bottom line. Call a Loan Depot loan officer and ask about our 27-year smart term loan or our 10-year ARM loan. Get a great rate matched with a great loan by calling 866-888-LOAN or visit LoanDepot.com. At Loan Depot, home means everything. Rates are subject to change. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing opportunity. NMLS number 174457. Licensed in all 50 states.
Micah Hanks is a writer, podcaster, researcher, and speaker whose interests cover a variety of subjects, including history, archaeology, science, and unexplained phenomena in nature. A longtime advocate for the study of unidentified aerial phenomena, Micah is a frequent commentator and writer who maintains an interest in the history and possible scientific explanations for aspects of the UFO phenomenon. He's a frequent guest on podcasts and radio programs and has been interviewed by Vice, CNN Radio, Coast to Coast AM, of course, Mysterious Universe, and a number of other outlets. He's been also a lecturer in America and Europe on a variety of subjects that include archaeology, UFOs, and historical mysteries. His list of published works includes The UFO Singularity, Magic Mysticism, and The Molecule, Reynolds Mansion, An Invitation to the Past, The Ghost Rockets, and Lost Secrets of the Gods. Micah, welcome back to Coast. How are you?
Richard, I am great, and it is wonderful to be here with you for this holiday discussion.
Absolutely. Well, this is intriguing. The proposal to establish something called the Anomaly Surveillance and Resolution Office within the Department of Defense, which would be charged with the task of gathering intelligence on UAP. Are you excited about this?
Well, I think a lot of people who have followed the UFO subject, or, you know, as our government prefers to call it now, unidentified aerial phenomena, yeah, a lot of us have been really excited about this, Richard, but of course there has been a breaking development, because even since we arranged to have this conversation, it appears that the Department of Defense has launched its own new UAP investigative element, which it calls a group. So now we've got one, but it's not quite the one that was proposed in the legislation, so now we get to talk about what might have been, what could possibly still be, and the one that was established earlier this week. Breaking news when it happens, huh?
Right, right. Well, I'm kind of getting confused because there are a number of these different groups now. There's this proposed Anomaly Surveillance and Resolution Office to gather intelligence. We had ATIP, the Advanced Aerial Threat Identification Program, which, depending on who you believe, is now defunct or still operational. And then we have the Navy's Unidentified Aerial Phenomenon Task Force. So help me kind of sort this all out. I mean, who's going to be doing what, and which of these offices, I guess, or study groups is most important in your mind?
That's a very good question, and thank you for asking that. You know, it is important to kind of establish the timeline. This really kind of goes back, at least as far as the public is concerned, to 2017. We had the groundbreaking reporting that appeared in the New York Times, which announced that there had been a Pentagon initiative that was looking at UAP. That came very much to the surprise of people like me. In fact, I've gone back using Wayback Machine and looked at the DOD website, at least until as recently as around February 2015, there was still a fact page that was available there at the website. And it was titled Unidentified Flying Objects, the old acronym used by the U.S. Air Force, and frankly, that a lot of people still use today. I do from time to time myself. But this fact page basically said, the DoD no longer looks at this issue, as you may already know. And then it essentially provides a very brief summary of the longest systematic study carried out by any government agency regarding UFOs. That, of course, is Project Blue Book, carried out by the U.S. Air Force from the early 1950s until about 1969. And that summary actually really almost word for word based on a 1986 document that had been released by Wright-Patterson Air Force Base that offered this brief summary, which essentially just said UFOs are no threat to national security. There is no reason for us to really continue to look at them, you know, but we did, and a few of them remain unexplained. So it's interesting that in 2015, that was what the official fact page there at the DoD website said, because now we know that at that same time, and in fact, a few years before that, there had in fact been an initiative. But once it was announced in the New York Times that the ATIP program that you mentioned there existed, there was already some confusion. There was further reporting that kind of put the question, you know, who had headed the program. Of course, it was understood and still is that Lou Elizondo had led that initiative at the Pentagon. But there had been a predecessor program called the Advanced Aerospace Weapons System Applications Program that was run out of the DIA, a combat support agency within the DoD. And we now know, because there was a memoir written about this by the guy who actually ran that program, I think he's been on Coast to Coast recently, James Lukatsky, that program had been the actual program that was funded as described in the New York Times. But at some point it was given a classified, or rather an unclassified nickname, that was ATIP. And according to Lukatsky, that was then thereafter borrowed by an informal initiative at the Pentagon, which also was called ATIP, and that was the one that Elizondo was a part of. Now, I've spoken briefly to Elizondo at length on one occasion, and then briefly a few times thereafter. And he seems to be as concerned as anyone with these current developments. But if we go back to last summer, of course, we had a bill that appeared that was proposing that essentially we had the United States Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, 116th Congress, second session, in this report that was filed on 17th of June last year, saying we support the efforts of the UAP task force. Now, at that time, a lot of us, Richard, were saying, oh, wait, hold on, there's a UAP task force? In fact, we'd known that there was at least some idea that there was some sort of a group, a task force operating. Roger Glassell, also John Greenwald Jr. at Black Vault, had both received some information about some kind of an effort. But this is the first time we actually saw in print from a government source the mention of an unidentified aerial phenomena task force. And just weeks later, it was actually announced by the DOD that they had authorized this and that this would operate under the Department of the Navy. Here again, a lot of people had questions. Doesn't the Air Force look at aerial threats? Now, I actually launched a news site with Tim McMillan and with MJ Benias called The Debrief back last December, and some of our early reporting that really kind of made a splash had to do with the fact that not only are there aerial issues being looked at, but also what are termed transmedium vehicles, vehicles that are able to go into water, come out of it. Again, this is actually nothing new to UFO proponents, because many who have followed this for decades will also know that going all the way back to the Blue Book, there were instances where UFOs were seen coming out of water or operating around it. So that's also something that's not necessarily new, but to see it in language with relation to government's operations looking into UFOs, that certainly is new. And the UAP task force, once it actually was authorized and once the bills for the Intelligence Authorization Act for fiscal year 2021 became law, they essentially said, look, within 180 days of this passing, this UAP task force is to deliver a report to the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, which we saw on time back in June. And the responses to that, I'm sure you saw it, I certainly did, and we reported on that at the debrief. They were mixed and varied. Some people said, nothing to see here. I mean, we've got a 9-page report with a cover letter and two appendixes in the back, so really it's 6 pages of content, no specific details. But at least for my own part and a lot of other people who have followed this for a very long time, we were looking at that report saying, current report saying we've got 144 instances of aerial phenomena that we can't identify, going all the way back to 2004, but most of this collected within the last couple of years by the Navy, and then the Air Force did get back into the game, essentially all from U.S. government sources. Most of these incidents involving aerial objects occurred during planned military training exercises, and more than 80 of them involved situations where there were multi-sensory records attained. In other words, we had, for instance, maybe a visual, but also radar and other different kinds of components that were actually tracking these objects. And so we had a pretty good idea based on these sensory capabilities that there was indeed an object and that multiple systems detected them. That certainly sounds like the government is investigating UAP, and now, you know, we know that they are. But there had been whispers even in recent weeks, Richard, that there may be something more formal than just a task force, a very limited staff, people with day jobs who in their spare time are also looking at what the intelligence community is gathering on this. And so we had a bit of a foreshadowing that there might be something else to come. And of course, in recent days, this Gillibrand Amendment involves a proposed amendment to the Defense Authorization Act for fiscal year 2022. Now, keep in mind, you know, the Senate had hoped to kind of get this all hashed out before Thanksgiving. They ended up having to put that on the back burner, and they're going to reconvene here in a few days. But before that could happen, rather quietly on Tuesday, as everybody was leaving Washington and going home to eat turkey, we see this announcement at the website of the Department of Defense. I'm actually looking at it in my browser right this very moment, and it says, DOD announces the establishment of the Airborne Object Identification and Management Synchronization Group, or AOIMSG. Try saying that three times fast.
But I'm in my head, Mike, I'm thinking about, let's say, a car crash or a fender bender on the highway, and you have all of these competing tow truck companies showing up, you know, vying for, jockeying for position. So is it, because I know part of the ASRO proposal would be for a rapid response team for a UAP field investigation. Are we going to have ASRO showing up at a UFO crash along with the UAP task force and this other group you just mentioned with all the letters, the long acronym? Are they going to be competing? Are they going to be coordinated? What is your sense?
Well, what we do know, of course, is that the currently operation, well, it's not currently operational because according to the release from the other day, the new organization, which I'm just going to refer to as the group, by the way, and I think it's a bit odd. We'll get a little more into the name and the odd choice of wording in the name a bit later, but I'll refer to it as the group because it is indeed a mouthful. But it is, as stated in the release from the DOD the other day, to essentially be the successor to the U.S. Navy's Unidentified Aerial Phenomena Task Force. That in the own, you know, the DOD's own wording. So we know this group is, you know, aimed at taking over for the UAP Task Force, and the intent would seem to be to provide a level of depth, you know, to actually have, you know, people maybe whose full-time job is to look at UAP. But a number of people have expressed concerns because it seems to be fairly limited in scope compared to what the proposed Anomaly Surveillance and Resolution Office would have done. So, you know, it may be helpful to kind of look at what that office would have done, and indeed it's a question as to whether if the Senate reconvenes and that still, or some version of the wording of the so-called Gillibrand Amendment, it was proposed by U.S. Senator Kirsten Gillibrand from New York and has received bipartisan support in recent days, but if that still were to pass, it would be interesting to see where this goes. Presumably, we already have something that has been kind of concocted to please those who would have wanted to see the Gillibrand Amendment pass. But I don't think that they're going to be competing agencies. We know, at very least, that the DOD's new group will actually take over for the UAP task force.
So the Anomaly Surveillance and Resolution Office, this proposed office, one of the, to me, the most exciting elements of this is the formation of a rapid response team for UAP field investigations. I mean, isn't that, before you can form a rapid response team, first of all, you have to acknowledge a need for it. So is this an admission that they will be sending a rapid response team out to UFO crash sites?
You know, based on the wording that was proposed in that proposed amendment, yeah, that would seem to be what we were looking at. And again, you know, there obviously has been some work behind the scenes to produce this, the wording in this amendment, because it's quite comprehensive. I mean, I've actually referred to it on my podcast as the most elaborately worded piece of proposed, you know, legislation, or really anything that we've seen in a number of decades from government, that is looking at the possibility that there are indeed aerial objects that we can't identify and that are worthy of study. But to quickly look at the actual wording in the proposed amendment, they note it calls for the designation of line organizations within the DOD and the intelligence community that possess appropriate expertise, authorities, accesses, data, systems, platforms, and capabilities to rapidly respond to and conduct field investigations of incidents involving unidentified aerial phenomena under the direction of the office. So, again, the proposed ASRO. Now, you know, if we go back in time again, Richard, and you know me, I'm a history guy, I think that the most important thing we can do right now, or at least one of the most important things apart from applying science toward the study of these, is to also know the history, because there's so much discussion these days about, well, it could be China. Maybe these objects belong to Russia, you know, or some other kind of foreign adversary. Listen, let me just point out that for those who know their history, I mean, well in advance of 1947 with Kenneth Arnold, you know, observing these strange objects flying over Mount Rainier, Washington, we had pilots observing unusual aerial phenomena. In fact, you know, the so-called Foo Fighters that were observed during World War II are just one really good example. The point is, there's a much longer history of this phenomenon, and we must ask ourselves, did the Soviets have something, you know, some breakthrough technology that appears to be in advance of our own aerospace capabilities today here in the United States in 1947? I would argue they didn't. But, of course, this is part of the reason why there was the establishment thereafter of Project Sign, then Project Grudge, and the next successor, which was Project Blue Book under the U.S. Air Force. And they spent almost two decades looking at these objects, trying to understand what they were. And they sure, you know, truly were field investigations at that time, but I would dare say they were fairly limited in scope compared to what this Gillibrand Amendment and its proposed ASRO would have done based on the language we just saw. I mean, we're talking about, essentially, to distill this down to its finest essence, we want the best of the best, the most capable people, you know, and highly trained, able to, you know, drop what they're doing, head out. When UAP are observed, you know, these, you know, individuals, these line organizations need to be able to be on call and able to respond.
And also, they have to report back to Congress and give briefings, both classified and unclassified. That's new as well, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Now, the UAP Task Force, as we know, back in June, it did, and much to my own surprise, I mean, I have to commend them, they were right on time with their deadline at the end of June, and they delivered a report to the Office of the Director of National Intelligence. By the way, the DNI, Admiral Haynes, having recently had, you know, quite a lot to say during a public forum about the UAP subject. We'll touch on that a bit later, too. But the idea that there would be ongoing reports provided to Congress, and again, as we saw with the ODNI report, there was a classified version of that report. Again, my colleague John Greenwald, Jr. of the Black Vault, he was able to obtain information about the length of the classified report. We haven't seen that yet. Obviously, it would have contained a little more detail than what the public saw, but it wasn't much longer, just a few more pages in the preliminary assessment that, you know, the classified version that members of the intelligence committees actually were able to see. Now, the one you and I saw, again, six actual pages of content, I still maintain there's actually quite a lot of information in there. I mean, for example, it stated a couple of times in that document that the FAA was supplying information to the UAP task force. The FAA has, for a long time, you know, as the civil aviation authority, you know, in the United States, I mean, they have maintained that they don't collect information about UFOs. And so when that report came out in June, I mean, I went right to work. And in fact, one of the stories I wrote that we broke there at the DVD.
Micah, pardon the interruption. I've got to jump in here. We're going to take a time out. Hollywood Vampires and Paul McCartney taking us into the break with Come and Get It right here on Coast to Coast AM. Yeah.
I'm Brian Bruman from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. A group of people have robbed a Home Depot in Lakewood. L.A. County sheriffs say the guys went to the tool department of the store and took a bunch of merchandise.
They had the gates closed, and they said that they had the sledgehammers ready to hit people who were trying to stop them.
Luis Romo says the guys then ran off and got into waiting cars. Four people who may have been part of this robbery were arrested in Beverly Hills. Cops in Beverly Hills got a call about cars without license plates on Beverly Drive Friday night. Cops were able to stop one car and arrest four people inside. The popular K-pop group BTS has four sold-out performances at SoFi Stadium. The first was last night. Fans from as far away as South Korea waited in line for close to 10 hours to buy merchandise. The seven-member group was the world's top-selling act of 2020 and is one of the most popular boy bands of all time. SoCal weather from KFI, sunny by the afternoon, low 70s at the beaches, upper 70s to low 80s in metro LA and OC, low to mid 80s in the inland valleys, and upper 60s to mid 70s in the inland empire. We lead local from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. I'm Brian Berubin.
If you love trivia, if you love the hugely popular Stuff You Should Know podcast, then the Trivial Pursuit game, Stuff You Should Know edition, is for you. With 600 questions, weird and unbelievable trivia in categories like myths, legends, and conspiracies. SYSK selects a mix of topics handpicked by podcast hosts Josh and Chuck. Give the gift of trivia this holiday. Find Trivial Pursuit, the Stuff You Should Know edition, at your favorite retailer or wherever you shop for board games.
As parents, we've done everything we can to keep our kids safe, happy, and healthy during this pandemic. From finding the best face masks, to making sure their hands are clean. And now we have the best tool to help keep them even safer. The most important thing we can do is vaccinate our kids to protect them against COVID-19. Vaccines have been proven safe and effective for children 5 and up. Talk to your child's doctor or visit myturn.ca.gov to find a vaccine near you. Brought to you by the California Department of Public Health.
We survived winter in Siberia, my mother told me, by literally eating dirt. Hello, I'm John Akoyan, owner of Rooter Hero Plumbing. I can't imagine living like that, but dirt, my mom told me, had nutrients. We are so fortunate to live in the world's richest country, but every day children go hungry. At Rooter Hero Plumbing, we want to help, so we're bringing back our Hero Helps program. Before COVID-19, we fed the homeless, adopted families, and cleaned the bay. But our most popular program was handing out canned goods. Rooter Hero will once again hand out food with no questions asked. Simply pull up in your car and we'll help your family. Go to rooterhero.com/herohelps for the date and location. If you want to donate canned goods, call us at 866-DRAIN77 for a Rooter Hero Plumbing location nearest you. Thank you.
Right now here on iHeartRadio Communities, we're talking about pandemic scams, how we can spot them, how we can avoid them. Right now I'm speaking to Abby Stimson. And when it comes to ways for everyone to stay on top of these scams, stay ahead of these scammers, what advice would you give those listening?
First, be skeptical of anyone who contacts you from the federal government. Right now, there's no official plan to create a national vaccine verification app or certificate or passport. Second, check with your airline or cruise line or event venue or, you know, wherever you're going about their requirements. Don't rely on information from someone who calls or texts or emails you out of the blue. Third, check out your State Department of Health to learn about its vaccine verification plans and requirements. And then fourth, just don't share your information with, you know, anyone pretty much. Before you share any information online, check out who's asking for it.
Thank you so much for coming on and sharing all of that great insight with us. We really appreciate it.
If you're even thinking about renovating, you have to check out the House website and app. That's H-O-U-Z-Z. More than 65 million people are using House because it's the best tool out there to help your project turn out right. Why? When you hire a pro on House, they can show you in 3D using House tools. exactly how your finished project will look. So for remodeling made easy, just go to House. That's H-O-U-Z-Z. And find a local pro to give you a great home and a great experience.
KFI, AM 640. More stimulating talk.
No one speaks English, and everything's broken in my state.